Well, you know, I have some mother-in-law, some mother kind of insights. Someone put them in here, so they're here. I'm going to read them. Let's see if they make any sense to any of us. First, it's a mother-in-law. We won't raise your hand. Okay, anyways, it says this. A newlywed farmer and his wife were visited by her mother, who immediately demanded an inspection of their new place. The farmer had genuinely tried to be friendly to his new mother-in-law, hoping that it could be a friendly, non-antagonistic relationship. All to no avail, though, as she kept on nagging them on every opportunity, demanding changes and offering unwanted advice, and generally making life unbearable to the farmer and his new bride. While they were walking through the barn that she insisted she must inspect, the farmer's mule suddenly reared up and kicked the mother-in-law in the head, killing her instantly. It was a shock to all, no matter how their feelings toward her demanding ways were. At the funeral service a few days later, the farmer stood near the casket and greeted the folks as they walked by. The pastor noticed that whenever a woman would whisper something to the farmer, he would nod his head yes and say something. Whenever a man walked by and whispered to the farmer, however, he would shake his head no and mumble a reply. Very curious as to this bizarre behavior, the pastor later asked the farmer what it was all about. The farmer replied, "Oh, it's simple. The woman would say, 'What a terrible tragedy,' and I would nod my head and sincerely say, 'Yes, it was.' Then the men would ask, 'Can I borrow that mule?' And I would like to, I would shake my head, 'No, I can't, because it's booked up for the next 2 years.'" Okay, it's one of those ba-da-bumps. Okay, it's like not very well. Here's something that might just lighten up everything here. Here's a mom. Okay, I'm gonna be like, here's a mom's letter to her son, but it says warning, redneck style. I'm just gonna read it. "Dear son, I'm writing this slow because I know you can't read fast. We don't live where we did when you left. Your dad read in the newspaper that most of the accidents happened within 20 miles of our home, so we moved. We won't be able to send you the address, as the last Arkansas family that lived here took the numbers with them for their new house so they wouldn't have to change their address. This place has a washing machine. The first day I put in 4 shirts, I pulled the chain. I haven't seen them since." "It only rained twice this week. 3 days the first time and 4 days the second. The coat you wanted me to send you, Aunt Sue said it would be a little too heavy to send in the mail with those heavy, heavy buttons upon it. So we cut them off and put them in the pockets." Some of you didn't get that. "We got a bill from the funeral home, and it said that if we didn't make the final payment, Grandma's funeral bill, up she comes. About your sister, she had a baby this morning. I haven't found out whether it's a boy or a girl, so I don't know whether you're an aunt or an uncle. Your Uncle John happened to fall into the whiskey vat in the backyard, so men tried to get him out, but he fought them off playfully. But in the end, he drowned. We cremated him, and he burned for 3 days." Excuse me. I'm almost done. 3 of your friends went off the bridge in a pickup truck. One was The one that was driving, so one was driving and the other two were in the back. The driver got out as he rolled down the window and swam to safety. The other two drowned because they couldn't get the tailgate down. I think I know these people. Not much more news this time. Nothing much happened. If you don't get this there, please let me know and I'll send you another one. Love, Mom. Oh, P.S. I was going to send you some money, but the envelope was already sealed. Happy Mother's Day. I know we have... I know that no moms on planet Earth exist like that, but I think I have some friends that are getting really close to that kind of... Let's pray. We definitely need it. Yeah. All right, Father, we come before you, and we do thank you for this morning, this Mother's Day Sunday. And I pray that we would hear what you are speaking to all of us as we celebrate Mother's Day, as we celebrate this day that we really believe, Father, not only for humanity, but biblically, that you've ordained to be celebrated. We thank you for your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to read from 2 Timothy chapter 1. Some of the verses will go up on the screen, and I begin with verse 5, and it reads this, and then I'll give you the background and help you understand. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, I'm persuaded is in you also. Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. Verse 8, therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings of the gospel according to the power of God. Paul is writing Timothy, and he is encouraging Timothy to use this force, this power that has gone dormant, to wake up something about his life. Paul is talking to him about this faith, the power of faith that he has deposited on the inside of him, to stir it up so that he can stir up the gifts that God has placed on him. You see, everything in the kingdom of God operates by faith. Everything is not circumstantial or sense-based. It's faith-based. And yet Paul calls it a genuine faith versus a counterfeit, bogus, or fraudulent faith. You know, he's talking about a genuine, authentic, true, and proven type faith. He's making reference to not only how far he's come, which I'll share in just a moment, and apparently something has happened to this young man by the name of Timothy, his protege. And he's reminding him, he says, in our vernacular, he's saying, hey, you have genuine, real faith. I've seen it in operation. It's not some cheap imitation, some knockoff version, some look-alike type faith, not some swap meet 10 cents, you know, look-alike, or something that is like make-believe, but rather it is the real thing that has proven itself in times of testing and trials and tribulation and even temptations. It is a genuine faith. It's holy, and it's inside of you. You see, Paul was attempting to unlock this faith. If God can get you and I and his people to unlock their faith and stir up what God has deposited on the inside of them, the exploits and the potential that's inside of you would come alive to degrees that maybe some of us have never even imagined. Timothy, see, had hit a wall, and he was under great pressure and persecution at his time, facing many, many problems. Yet at the same time, he was very, very accomplished in his life. You see, historically, theologians have written about Timothy that at this present time of writing, he was over a church or overseeing 100,000 people. He was considered to be the bishop of his day. That's why in the readings of 1 and 2 Timothy, you see a lot of references to Paul writing of how to put church in order with bishops and deacons and elders. And a lot is said about church leadership in those two books. And yet Paul comes to him and he's reminding him about these unusual characteristics. He's saying, hey, this faith is on the inside of you. This is mountain-moving faith, Timothy. He says, God didn't give you a spirit of fear, but apparently fear was intimidating him. God didn't raise you up to be ashamed of the gospel, yet he had the spirit of shame that was attacking him. And Paul the Apostle, by the Spirit of God, was acknowledging and pinpointing what was going on in Timothy's life as a young leader, as an accomplished leader. And all of a sudden, he shifts in trying to revive and awaken him. The Spirit of God brings to Paul the Apostle's mindset about Timothy's background in history. And he begins to point out something that is needed to be understood on this day. So Paul begins to paint a memorable portrait, a picture, if you like, a point of contact, a point of reference that is stimulating and is soul-searching and is, you know, emotional concerning two people. And that triggers something inside of Timothy, this young, accomplished leader who seems to be stuck in a dilemma of persecution. And it begins to trigger memories of sacrifice, begins to trigger memories of surrender, difficult choices made when he was in a much younger situation prior to embracing all that responsibilities of this moment, and who it was that built a foundation so that he would ultimately become one of Paul the Apostle's proteges. You see, Paul made reference to Timothy's grandmother, Lois, and to Timothy's mother, Eunice. And why this is important for us to understand historically is Paul is addressing, causing Timothy to remember what has been placed on the inside of you and how that placement even got there. You see, this really is a picture of two single mothers without a biological father at the present writing. You know, these two single mothers, if I may say, this grandmother and this mother, grandmother Lois and mother Eunice, were raising a single man, historians say. There was no other siblings. Born of a Greek father, and thus causing the mother to live as an outcast religiously in that day. It was what you would call an interracial marriage, and it caused conflict. This was probably prior to Paul the Apostle going to Lystra and doing an evangelistic campaign and them giving their lives to the Lord. But nevertheless, Paul is bringing this to his remembrance, and I could only imagine that Timothy begins to think back to the days when he was young and the sacrifices that his mother and his grandmother had to make. I'm going to make more reference to his mother Eunice, since there is honor given to the grandmother, but we don't know whether the grandmother was still living, but that Paul does credit the grandmother for the mother's faith and then for Timothy's faith. But in that day, you have to understand, as a single mother, that was a disadvantage to great proportions. There was a lot of prejudicial things going on at that time. The climate was thick with dissension. Women were undervalued in that particular society. And it was a harsh workforce environment for any woman, let alone a single woman, who were not really considered or valued in high esteem in society. The socioeconomic, therefore, challenges were extremely difficult. It was a spiritual, hostile, and a very aggressive religious environment where there was persecution against Christians, where they would drag people out on the streets or even calling the name of Christ. And the pressure that was there with the Greek goddesses and open just idol worship was absolutely beyond one's imagination, let alone the oppression of the Roman government. Well, all of that was going on, and here was this grandmother Lois and this mother Eunice raising up a single young man. You talk about the odds being against you. But Paul does not come with any kind of patronizing in soft sell about these two powerful mothers. Paul is not patronizing these mothers. Neither is the Holy Spirit trying to stir in your heart here today in a haphazard way, a nonchalant idea about motherhood. Although there are many facets to motherhood, in this particular setting, it's a live or die situation. The kingdom of God is at hand. And Timothy has to be stirred, and the Holy Spirit brings to Paul the apostle's remembrance a deposit that was made that he wants Timothy to remind himself. See, the Bible has no room for wasted, empty, useless, and meaningless words such as grandmother and mother. They're very specific and they're very meaningful. Again, I remind you that Lois and grandmother Lois and Eunice came up in a Jewish upbringing, but Eunice intermarried and caused her to be an outcast, impure. And so that began. And on top of that, then the father, who was a Greek, did not agree with the Hebrew way of living or Jewish law, refused to have Timothy as a young boy circumcised in the Jewish law, therefore making reference that he was opposed to that lifestyle or that religious upbringing. So that caused even further division. And but then the father ends up dying. And so here is a young man without a father, and everybody in society with the wrong mindset would say, well, this young man is just going to be another statistic, you know, to the cravings of a world gone crazy. The word Lois means to be agreeable or to desire. The word Eunice is an interesting word in itself. This is what the grandmother named her daughter. This all has impact upon the life of Timothy. Timothy means honoring God. And the grandmother names her daughter Eunice, which means conqueror, which means to experience a good and happy victory. See, in the Macedonian way of living, in the sector of the culture of that day, a favorite female name ending would be N-I-C-E, Eunice, also spelled N-I-K-E, the original Nike. I'm just saying. And it does mean to be victorious and triumphant, as you would understand. I guess she would be the original swoosh. She didn't pick up on it. Anyways, so what I'm trying to share with you, she was not only called, would be referred to as Eunice, but I guess we can call her Eunike. All right, but it works. Anyways, so Eunike lived up to her name, for she conquered in the effort to raise up her son and nurture him in the admonition and the fear of the Lord without a biological father, which is no small undertaking. But sometimes we look at certain people. We look at them naturally, and we don't realize what God has done in them spiritually. Paul is not talking about some victims, some female, weak-minded, unable, inept individuals called grandmother and mother. Rather, he is stirring up this powerful young leader to remember where he got his strength, to remember where he got his warring spirit, to remember how far he has gone. And this is really an absolute branding of a new way of thinking for even many of us when we celebrate these wonderful times such as Mother's Day. But I'm sure, you know, Timothy began to reflect back that Mother Eunice had to make many concessions, many tough decisions, oftentimes had to press on beyond personal aggression and push forward beyond difficult circumstance, and maybe move ahead regardless of the socioeconomic conditions of her day. But she had a focus in her life. His name was Timothy. You know, it was a hostile environment, and she primarily, though outcast, though ridiculed, though called many things in her day, she chose to live for Jesus Christ. With persecution and with pressure, with the Roman government oppression, and made to feel like her choice early in life for intermarriage, interracial marriage, was incorrect, and therefore caused her to live sidelined in the view of others. God had her in the proper view all the time. And so, without doubt, she had certain defining moments. And I'm sure, like many of you and many of us and many mothers and many of all of us, regardless of our background, though she had plenty of those what I call God encounter times where you don't know what to do, but to come to the point in your life where you fall to your knees and cry out for help because you don't really know your next step. You don't really know what's going to happen. So it takes everything in you to believe God and to trust Him. And those moments define and refine. And I'm sure Timothy began to think of the sacrifices and the surrenders and the choices his mother had to make, and that it came out to become the kind of young man he was. Eunike, or Eunice, you know, it kind of reminds me a little bit of, I'm sure, your mother in many ways, but certainly of my mother. You know, my mother came over from Mexico legally. Just thought I'd throw that out there. And just in case some of you were wondering. Basically, single-handedly, though there was a biological father, my father went on world tour. I don't say that to discredit. I just say that to explain and define something for your clarification. Raised me and my sister in a very difficult and hostile environment. When she came over, she didn't know English. She did not have a job skill per se. So she went to the thing where she went to the one particular job to provide for her children, where no other provision was coming. And of course, you know, to the working fields, from picking of lettuce to tomatoes to lemons and everything like that. Until she could put herself through night school and learn some English, and then begin to develop a skills in the field of electronics to learn a particular skill to get better, another level of economic influx coming in. But the point I'm trying to say, that without her having to explain anything, and I'm sure that Timothy's mother, Eunice, or Eunike, never sat down and said, okay, I'm making a hard choice here. We don't know that. And I'm sure you mothers made a lot of those choices. And your sons and daughters have seen you make those choices. Maybe they don't exactly understand them in the moment because of their age at the time. But God will bring it to their remembrance, the sacrifices and the concessions and the tough decisions that you had to make in order to bring a greater livelihood to your children. Paul is bringing that up deliberately to Paul the apostle, to bring him back to the foundation of his strength. And so, as I was saying, you know, I'm sure our moms, like mine, made many, many of those decisions, those defining moment decisions. I remember she had an encounter, you know, that she shared with me later on in her life, because didn't understand this, but because she married outside the church, she was outcast as well from the church that she was attending for so many years. They wouldn't receive her as one of their own, though she would come and visit. Great opportunity for a person to reject God. But she never rejected God, rather kept God not only in the center of her heart, but she kept her two children centered on God with what she understood about God at that time. And then at the day that I was 40 years old, when somebody wanted to offer to purchase me because they knew my mother could not afford to raise us up, she refused but took me to the nearby mausoleum, just refer to it as that, and offered me up and dedicated me to the Lord and said, I don't want to let go of my son, but I do dedicate him to you. That's why I believe in, you know, child dedications. There's something that really happens there that's really powerful. I look forward to our next one. But I want you to understand that you mothers, you've made those decisions at times. You've had those God encounters, you know, and I want you to realize those God encounter times are defining moments. First, for you mothers, I speak to you primarily this morning, and the God encounters you have in your life will have collateral benefits for the children in your life. And these trusting God moments where you let go and you let God be everything He says He wants to be in your life are some of the most important defining moments that help shape a generation beyond your understanding. Recently, last week, we had a God encounter. We had an encounter weekend. We have them about once or twice a year. We don't have the privilege of sharing, or haven't. Now we are changing things where we have on a Sunday night, people come and they share. Four or more people come to stage and they share their story amongst all the other individuals. Every person that goes to an encounter weekend has an amazing story to tell. All of them moving to the core of your being if we had time to listen to their stories. It's time that's spent on a Friday and a Saturday morning and day, and then a little bit on Sunday, and then they come and we celebrate them. And last weekend I heard all the stories, and they were all very, very powerful. And I'd like to share with you, because it happens to be with what is a single mom right now. But I saw as I was sitting there in my chair, listening to not only all the stories that were being shared, but this one particular one, it stirred this entire message. Reminded me as I was sitting there of Timothy's mother called Eunice, Eunike. I heard a sound from this story of victory. I heard a sound of humility. I heard a sound of surrender. And I thought, how blessed will her children be? And this is what she shared. Listen.
So I've been going to Word of Life since I was 5 years old. I went to Word of Life Academy and I graduated from there. So I've been like raised in a godly home. I've been raised with godly values. So me, and I've seen like the way that my dad, the way that he treats my kids is the way that I want. That's the example that I want for them. And I'm just so thankful for them, really. And what led me to this encounter was I want that wholeness. I want that family, you know. I've been like really struggling raising them on my own, and I took matters into my own hands, and for years, because how many of us want to be in control, you know, especially us women? Like, we want to know everything. We want to know the end from the beginning. So that's how I was, and I knew that trusting God would take the control away from me. So for years I've been doing that, and it was just so hard, and it made me so bitter and angry with myself, and like it was just so stressful. And from week after week, when I would talk to Sam, I would just be like, how do I do this? Like, what do I do? What do I have to do? And she was like, you need to go to an encounter. And I was like, because I know what the encounter is, you know. I know that you have to let go, and it's like that was a place that I was just hiding from. I didn't wanna let go, you know, and I didn't wanna be vulnerable. But I'm just so glad that I did, because it freed me, you know. Upset anymore, and God is just dealing with me and me letting go, really, and really being an example, a godly example to my kids, and also a godly example to the women that are going through the same thing that I'm going through. So that being said, I just want to read my letter. Dear God, I want to thank you for being here for me throughout my entire life. It amazes me every single day that despite all of the times that I have left you, and all of the times that I've taken my life from you because I wanted to be in control, all the times that I've fallen, you are always there to lift me up. You are always there to pick up the pieces, and you are the only one there when no one else was. Every time I ran to you, I felt your warmth and your peace and your forgiveness. When I feel you, my worry, my heartache, and my pain is gone. I want to say thank you for never giving up on me, even when I felt like giving up on myself. For always being there for me when I needed you. I trust you with my whole heart. Now I can finally let go of controlling my life and let you take control. I'm finding my peace in you. I'm not worried about my family and about my boys, because as I focus on you and as you mold me, all of that will come into place. Because of my encounter with you, I feel so refreshed and free, and I thank you for everything. I love, love, love you. Love your daughter, Justine.
Come on, let's put our hands together. Amen. Wow. What an amazing story. Justine, are you in the house? She might be somewhere in that here. Oh, there she is. Hi, Justine. There she is. Radiant. Thank you for allowing us to hear your story. What an amazing story. Wow. And Justine is vulnerable again, as she said, to share her story with all of you. And it's been such a blessing. I've heard people just tell me already how it moved them to understand the importance of an encounter. We pray you would also understand the importance of the encounter. But let me head towards the finish as well by saying that, you know, we can justify, you know, the observance of Mother's Day on scriptural grounds. There are plenty of admonitions regarding motherhood, the influence of godly mothers as they endeavor to raise up their children in their time frames biblically. But I want you to take note that Paul is not glorifying some frail and fragile, feeble female vessel, but rather he's trying to brand in the mind of all the believers who read the scriptures in their hearts that there is power in God's grace, in his ability to raise up fierce, faith-filled, not only mothers, but a generation. And he's reminding Timothy his roots of his mother's attributes, fierce and fearless, unashamed, faith-filled, and fully devoted. I'm certain that as I just read some of the history, there was struggles in her days. But this perseverance, you know, took a decision upon this mother to raise up that young man by the name of Timothy, who became one of the greatest leaders of the New Christian Foundation in the world. You know, I want you to understand that he speaks, Paul does, contrary to the sickly sentimentality or shallow, you know, pursuits and empty emotionalism that's often characterized by an undercurrent of pity and victim mentality towards women. That is not at all what you hear when Paul the Apostle mentions grandmother Lois and mother Eunike, you know, just by definition of their words. And you need to hear that. And that although Paul the Apostle became this later on the spiritual father of Timothy, what he's doing is he's giving honor to whom honor is due. He's saying, hey, Timothy, I want you to realize, I know I may have been speaking into your life now that you've gotten into this position for a number of years, but we must give honor to who made the deposit in you that I could even begin to work with. That is your mother, Eunice. She was the more than a conqueror. She had a spirit upon her that I would call not only grandmother Lois, but mother Eunice, as warriors with arrows in their hands. And I share that, and I close with this verse. And I want you mothers to think of this. I want you mothers to understand this much. Timothy, because he was so high up and had the more of the Jewish mindset, he had to memorize the Psalms and the writings of Solomon, Proverbs, and many scriptures to memory. And he knew exactly what Paul the Apostle was making reference to in terms of bringing to his attention grandmother Lois and mother Eunice. It could be, no doubt, that he was making reference to Psalms 127, 3 and 4. I tend to believe that very strongly from scriptures combined together, where it says, behold, children are the heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. As arrows in the hand of a warrior. Can you say that? As arrows in the hand of a warrior. In this particular case, the warrior is that parent. In this particular day, I make reference to that warrior being you mothers. And I want you to understand this. The arrows are your children. The warrior is you. Mother Eunice had that warrior spirit about her. She was a fighter. That's what a warrior is. A warrior, by definition, is a person who fights in battles and is known for having courage and having skill. A person who is fearless in a struggle and is willing to persevere. A person who demonstrates great vigor and aggression and refusal to live passive or to bow to compromise. It's the characteristic, this warrior spirit of our Heavenly Father, Exodus says, the Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. I close with the five things that just quick mentions of what a warrior, you mothers, do with these arrows or have done with these arrows. First of all, a warrior must keep the arrows close by their side. If ever you're going out, those arrows have to be within your reach, normally kept close to your person, either on your back or around you. And that's dealing with relationship, the importance of the relationship between the warrior and the arrow, the mother in this particular case, and the child. Secondly, a warrior must know how to grip the arrows with skill. It's that touch that a mother can only bring to a child. It's so important, you know, and it's important that we understand, because that touch is what helps mold, what helps mature. The third thing is a warrior provides the arrow's strength to be propelled. It's the warrior who has to pull back with, in this case, her strength for that arrow to even be fastened and to have strength to travel whatever distance. And that the emphasis word on that is the strength that the warrior brings. You mothers, you have brought strength to the arrows of your life and the arrows of your day. Fourthly, a warrior provides the arrow's direction. You know, this speaks of this. As that arrow is growing up and being shaped, you are providing direction in this sense, speaking to your arrows, your children, in terms of destiny and vision, ability and accomplishment, their potential beyond circumstance. You speak by ways of faith. You speak by ways of encouragement. You add to their perspective. You give them depth, and you give them breath of life. And finally, a warrior must release that arrow. There is a time in the season where you must trust in what you've shaped that arrow to do, to hit the target. And that's what you must trust them in, releasing them, and trust them they will accomplish what God has set out. Our job was to be the warrior and to pour into that arrow, to direct that arrow, to release that arrow, which is a trust that never ends between the warrior and that arrow. And I want you to realize that is what I see in you mothers, and that is what you've accomplished. Either your arrows are still by your side and still being shaped, or you've already released them. Trust the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not to your understanding. Acknowledge him in all of your ways. They'll bring back the prize. They'll talk about the target they hit because of what you did in their life. Amen? Give the Lord a great big hand clap. We applaud you, mothers. Mothers, would you please stand once again to your feet? We want to just say, I want to pray for you and thank God for you one more time. Lord, we come before you this morning. How honored we are to have so many mothers here that represent the shaping of a generation. Father, you alone know the giftings, the talents of every arrow, of every mother that stands here. We're not putting aside the value of a father, but on this particular day, Lord, we're bringing to our remembrance a day that you called us, all humanity, to honor. Put it in the hearts of men of every tongue, of every tribe, on every continent. Today, we remind ourselves of the encouragement that we have from our mothers that have invested in us, deposited, made concessions, decisions, that all of us standing here who were once children will never even imagine, have never even thought were made. They were done on our behalf. So we stand today, Lord. And these mothers stand today, and they've done the same with their children. Their arrows But they know, Lord. They know that they are warriors of their generation. Though there are many beautiful and wonderful descriptive characteristics of kindness and beauty and compassion and love, generosity, virtue and value that can describe any one mother standing on her feet. This morning, Lord, you bring to our attention the strength of a mother, the value of a mother that helps shape a generation. We as a church pray for these mothers. We pray for every mother, grandmother, mother-to-be. We pray for them, Lord God. We thank you for their lives. Cover them and bless them. Protect them and prosper their lives. Whatever they set their hand to do, especially on their arrows, Lord, give them wisdom beyond their experience. And give them assurance of heart that now that they've released their arrows, some standing here, that trusting you, Lord, is what you've called us to do. Lord, I thank you for the virtue, the value, Father God, and the worth of every mother. And may today they be celebrated as never before. May they be honored for the mothers that they are, young or seasoned, experience or just beginning. Lord, today your blessing is upon these mothers. Bless them, Father God. Bountifully bless them, Lord. And may friendships, Father God, in their lives be strengthened. And may all relationships be mended, restored. And Father God, may you comfort every mother's heart for the dedication and the foundation they set in preparing those arrows to reach a destiny you've placed in their hearts. We thank you in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen and amen. Come on, put your hands together for your moms. Would everyone please stand to your feet? Amen.